K98 Talk is expanding its lineup for 2015. This means we are expanding our advertising base. Whether you're a startup trying to push through to the next level, or an established business trying to supplement your advertising budget, web-based advertising is a solid investment. Thanks to Talk's newest partnership with TuneIn Radio and instant access to our sister station, K98 FM, we give you worldwide access at a reasonable cost. Interested parties should email us at sales@k98fm.com. K98talk.com, a leader in internet radio. So grab your seatbelts and take the ride of your life on K98talk.com.
This is the Liz Harrison Show.
Good afternoon, folks. I'm Liz Harrison. Thank you for listening to Vigilant Liberty Radio. And if you're catching this on K98talk.com, thanks for listening there. It is Monday, February 23rd. It is freezing here in Pennsylvania. Of course, it's freezing a lot of places where it really shouldn't be. Tennessee, Texas. Looked at the news this morning and was like, oh my God, flipped vehicles in the DFW metro area. Wow. Yeah, that's scary. Because I know it's one thing when we get it here because we're used to it. I see it down there and I'm like, oh my goodness. Those folks just are totally not prepared. Just saying. Sand. They use sand. I laugh at that. You know, we use salt. Sand. I wonder how that works for y'all. Of course, by the end of the week, they'll have it all gone. It will be in the 60s by the end of the week here. I'll be sinking down near zero, probably. Yeah. I may or may not be able to get the salt off the vehicles before April. They keep promising that the temperature is going to go above 32. And then they change the broadcast. You know, change the forecast. Gotta love it. Okay, maybe not. We had a very mild winter up until January, so I should not be complaining. Really? Okay, I will anyway. Y'all don't want to hear about the weather. That's no fun. The Oscars were on last night. This is filed under I really don't care. I don't watch them. Yeah, I don't care. And a lot of Americans don't either. They had a drop of 14% in viewership in adults aged 18 to 49. Yeah. And it was viewed by 34.6 million people between 8:30 and 11 p.m. in the early results. This is according to Deadline Hollywood, of course. That's down 14% from 40.2 million that watched the show over the same period of time last year. Okay. And they're claiming, they're saying these numbers are early, you know, whatever that means. The only time we had lower viewership was in 2008. with a final viewership of 32.0 million. So 32 million straight up. I can't even believe that many people watch it. I'm serious. And it's getting down to the point where, is it really meaningful at all? Of course, it didn't help any. They have politicized it. They politicize everything. Let's politicize all the things. I mean, they did it at the Grammys. The hands up thing. Which I didn't watch that either. Filed under I don't care. Birdman won Best Picture. I'm ambivalent. I mean, I like Michael Keaton. But what really ticked me off was Patricia Arquette. Her little speech when she got the Best Supporting Actress for her performance in Boyhood, a movie that I probably will not see. To every woman who gave birth, to every taxpayer and citizen of this nation, said Arquette, we have fought for everybody else's equal rights. It's our time to have wage equality once for all. And equal rights for women in the United States of America. Really? Okay. Now, I understand. Wage equality is a hot button issue. Okay. What people fail to recognize is that gender is not the only thing. Okay? And I can't believe this. I'm almost going to halfway defend Hillary Clinton here, so hold on tight. Okay? Hillary Clinton, as reported at Washington Free Beacon, Hillary Clinton portrays herself as a champion of women in the workforce, but women working for her in the U.S. Senate were paid 72 cents for each dollar paid to men, according to a Washington Free Beacon analysis of her Senate year's salary data. During those years, the median annual salary for a woman working in Clinton's office was $15,708.38 less than the median salary for a man, according to the analysis of data compiled from official Senate expenditure reports. Okay, and they go on to show men and women. Okay. Now, this is nothing new. Okay, we're going to keep this clear here. There's nothing new here. I have only one problem. And I'm looking through this. Let me see. I'm reading through. Guess what? In all of this, they only state how much these women are paid. They do not say anything about the circumstances of their employment versus the circumstances of the men. Now, I'm going to make a point here. It's very important. When the husband was at his previous employer, the current employer, they frown upon overtime at all. Okay? They want them out the door, 5 p.m. They want to walk up and they want to go home. The previous employer, not so much. Some people would stay late, including him. The women who worked there, with few exceptions, and those exceptions had to do with the fact that they showed up late. You know, they'd start work later in the day and they'd leave later in the day, so it's not really fair to sit there and say, oh, they worked longer too. No, not really. They probably worked less hours than him. After you take into account the fact that they showed up later in the day. So, and the reason why they show up later in the day is because of putting kids on buses, etc., etc. So, the husband made more than some of them. Some of them made more because their positions were arguably just more, they had more responsibilities and had to do with larger issues in the company. He only worked in one department. They had stuff to do with the whole company. So that's understandable. But they would sometimes make less than men, too, who also were doing work with the whole company, because let's go back to the previous, they'd show up later at work and they'd leave either at the same time as everyone else or not necessarily staying long enough to say that they were putting in as many hours as anyone else. And we're talking salaried workers here, so we're not talking you click in with the time card. Yeah, they were given allowances because they were women and had responsibilities at home. So I'd like to know about the circumstances of employment for the women versus the men among Hillary Clinton's Senate staff. Knowing just the raw numbers doesn't tell the story. It just doesn't. You have to take into account, are they putting in as many hours when they're a salaried worker? What is their job description versus their male counterparts? Are they doing a job that is as complex as what the men are doing? Maybe, maybe not. See, this is what is so disingenuous about this argument. It really is, because this does not exist in a vacuum. It has nothing to do with just gender. It doesn't. Yes, there are women out there who will work overtime. There are women out there who will do silly stuff like spend 7 days out of a week on air or producing. Talking about me there. That happens. But I have the advantage of being able to sit there and say, I'm not going to do this, that, and the other because I have family stuff. Makes sense? A lot of women do this in the workplace. Does that make them worth less money? Probably. There is a give and take. If you as an employer have to give a greater amount of flexibility in scheduling work situations, even workload, a woman versus a man, why should you be forced to pay the woman the same rate you pay a man when you get more productivity out of the man? And I'm not saying that women are incapable of being as productive as men. I'm saying that in the circumstances when they are not, there is no earthly reason to force an employer to pay them the same amount. I wonder how many of the women that were working for Hillary Clinton's Senate staff had made arrangements that maybe they would come into the office a little bit late because they had to put the kids on the bus. And maybe they ended up taking an odd-timed lunch break, again, to deal with the same. Or maybe they just flat-out left early. You're a salaried employee. You make these arrangements with your employer. This is doable. The logic of salary is that you get a list of things that you must have done, and it doesn't really matter how long it takes you. As long as your workload is completed, the hours don't really matter. At least that's the way it can be. So, I really want to see some honest reporting on this. I really do. And I don't know that we can. Because at best, we're only going to be able to know most of the time how much someone is paid. We are not going to be able to find out what their work conditions are. At least not the way that they're doing these surveys at this point. It's arguably an invasion of the privacy of the workers and, for that matter, of the employer. Do they really need to be telling the public this? But, yeah, when it comes to politics, yeah, Hillary Clinton needs to come out and say why this is the case. And if it is because of, you know, the women who are working for her have a, or the women who were working for her when she was in the Senate, if they had more flexible schedules, et cetera, then, yeah, there is a good reason to not pay them as much as the men. She was giving them something else that was worth that 28 cents an hour. It's felt under priceless. That's what people don't understand or don't want to talk about. If special allowances are given for a woman in the workplace so that they can do things in their personal life and the men are not doing those things, yeah, there's a good reason to pay them less. There it is, right there. Because not all pay is cash. We all understand this. You get bonuses, you get health care, you get retirement funds, you get vacation time, you get personal time. And there is give and take for some of that. I mean, even if it's down to the point where these women who were paid less ended up with more personal time than the men, were they really being paid less? No. They're not, because that time is worth something. Infuriating. So infuriating. And I hate it when I have to be forced to justify what's going on. I mean, this is just saying that, you know, this whole wage equality thing. This is fouled under, stop it. Just stop. You want to know what the real issue is? You're sitting there and you're demanding that the government sit there and make it all right for women. Force wage equality. When the problem either is, one, women are given some other benefit, whether it's free time or flexibility in their hours or something, that equals things out, because those are filed under things that have value, but they don't have dollar values per se. So it's either that or a failure in education. Yeah, it is a failure in education. If liberals really wanted to do right by women, instead of playing this game, they would be sitting there saying, okay, we want to see colleges and trade schools and even high schools take girls aside and teach them the skills necessary to stand up for themselves in a job interview situation and negotiate for higher wages. This is something that women historically do not do. They don't do it. The only ones who really do it on a regular basis are the individuals who are out there doing freelance work, and even there, a lot of the time, they undervalue themselves. And you're an idiot if you think that the corporate America or any part of business or employer of any kind, government, it doesn't matter. If you think that any of them are going to correct them and say, no, 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 honey, you're worth more than that. Yeah, right. It's not going to happen. That's the problem, people. If they're not receiving some special situation that makes their lives easier in lieu of payment in the form of a higher wage. Like, they're not getting flexibility, they're not getting flex hours, they're not getting extra personal time off so that they can take off early or come in late because of kids or whatever. And they're just doing the same work and working the same hours as the men, and they're still getting paid less. I guarantee you it is because of a failure to negotiate for a higher wage. It is a situation where women undervalue themselves. So teach them. Stop whining and teach them. I mean, there are a few organizations that have started to try to do this, but you never hear them mentioned by any of the liberals. I have to go look some up. I really do. It's been a while since I looked. Women need to realize it's called Glassdoor. Go look there. See what people are being paid for what you're doing. Negotiate accordingly. They start trying to talk you down, you start talking about going out the door. Go in there armed. Know what it is. Glassdoor is there to let you know what these places are paying for what you want to do. No reason why you shouldn't be paid as much as everyone else, but it's not the government's job to guarantee that. And it is a disservice to women because it makes them a special class that needs help. Oh, they can't take care of themselves, so we've got to step up and protect them. Yeah, that's helpful. That's going to make everything all better. They're definitely going to be treated the same as men. They're going to have complete equity in the workplace because they needed the government to help them. Nope, not working. Sorry, doesn't work that way. That's going to make them look down on you even more than they already did. Just saying. And of course, this follows through to the lovely little hashtag game that they were playing last night when it comes to the red carpet. Ask her more. Ask her more than about the dress she's wearing. Now, to be fair, this is something that y'all built on yourselves. They put up this special little section on the red carpet with the pretty background. What for? All of the women to stand in front of it and have their pictures taken and do a little twirl around and make little sexy poses for the camera. And then you're going to complain that all anybody wants to know about is which designer made your dress. I understand. It makes complete and total sense. You're going to put yourself out there as a fashion plate, an actress. Oh, I'm sorry. Female actor. Is that it? Or an actor in a female role. Is that it now? I want to be politically correct here, you know? Okay, maybe I don't. But seriously, come on now. Ask her more. Do they even know who is on the red carpet asking questions? They're not really journalists. Yeah, I just said that. Sorry, ABC. I mean, you sent all of your Good Morning America people out there. Poor George Stephanopoulos. I actually feel sorry for him sometimes. I really do. For the crap that they make him do. It is beneath him, theoretically. But who knows? Maybe he's become so intellectually soft that this is the best he can manage at this point. I mean, I'll disagree with him. But he used to be a relatively smart guy. Now I'm starting to wonder. Ask him questions at the red carpet. No. The place where they ask them more is after you've won the award. Backstage. That's where you get the more. You gotta earn it, sweetheart. That's all. Because they don't have time. Number one, there's too damn many of you coming in. And all that the people really care about when you're walking in on that red carpet is what are you wearing? They'll care about what's going on in your head after you manage to win something. And it is down to, we don't have time for this. There are too many of you. If you want to start restricting how many people could show up at the Oscars, go ahead. I mean, we have God knows how many actors and actresses that nobody can remember doing anything for the previous year. Why are they there? Who knows? I mean, if they had the year off or they were filming and nothing was released yet, then maybe they don't need to be there. Or maybe the press needs to ignore them. There you go. Oh, yeah, that's not going to happen. Because they'll wear something really flamboyant. And they'll have to ask them, what's your dress? Who made your dress? Give me a break. You're in a shallow career. Your purpose in this world is to entertain people. You attempt to politicize it and make yourself appear to have depth. Hollywood has become a series of repetitions. Doubt that? Look at all of the reboots. Is it really necessary? I mean, oh, wait, we better not forget about the latest one that is going to have all of the women going nuts because, you know, you must be sexist if you don't like the Ghostbusters with women. No. No, Ghostbusters is on the realm with being a cult film. And I'll introduce you to the concept. Cult films have really, really loyal fans. They don't want anybody messing with it. Just saying. You messed with it. You put women in those positions. Really? No. I have zero interest in seeing it. I am not sexist. I am not saying that I don't want to see it because I don't think that women are capable of acting. I am saying that those parts, by no stretch, there is no way that you will have the proper chemistry. Just not going to work. It's not. You have to have the sleazy doctor who hits on the woman, Bill Murray's character. You have to have that. You have to have the geekdom going on at the level that the men can do it, by the way. It doesn't make sense otherwise. I'm a purist. I'm not a sexist. I just think, you know, that's not working. Definitely not working. Mm-mm. It's like sacrilege on some bizarre level. The fact that y'all thought of putting women in those parts. Oh my goodness. I don't even want to think about what the script looks like. Really, I don't. And I'm not saying that you can't have kick-ass women. Oh, hell, I love Tomb Raider. Oh, wait, you're not going to like her because, you know, big bust or something. She's too sexy. Whatever. Anyway, it's the bottom of the hour. time for the news. When I get back, we'll be talking a little bit about the crazy terrorist crap that's going on. And, well, at the very least, a job that is probably dirtier than the job you do. Just saying. We'll be right back. This is your Vigilant Liberty Radio news from Independent Journal Review for Monday, February 23rd. MSNBC senior White House correspondent Chris Jansing explained the people who buy Obamacare receive a special tax form to file. Apparently, the government sent out these forms with the wrong information. Jansing reports the corrected form will be sent out in the first week of March. People affected by the error will find their accounts at healthcare.gov updated. Jansing described the situation. What is already, let's all face it, no one's favorite time of year, tax time just got a little more complicated for almost a million Americans. The error could end up delaying tax returns and subsequent tax refunds for those waiting on a corrected form, said Jansing. Since healthcare.gov came online in 2013, it has been plagued with problems. The Obamacare website continued to crash regularly, even on March 2014's deadline day. This summer, officials admitted that healthcare.gov was still not complete. Arizona Senator John McCain made a shocking admission relating to the U.S. position on Ukraine on live television. Yahoo News reports that while appearing on Face the Nation, McCain told host Bob Schieffer, "I'm ashamed of my country, I'm ashamed of my president, and I'm ashamed of myself that I haven't done more to help these people. It is really, really heartbreaking. I believe the German Chancellor and President of France legitimized for the first time in 70 years the dismemberment of a country in Europe. It's shameful. Vladimir Putin has not paid any price." Though Secretary Kerry mentioned that supplying the fighters with weapons was an option being considered, McCain seems to believe the U.S. should have done that long ago. The Ukrainians are not asking for American boots on the ground, but merely weapons to defend themselves against the Russian onslaught. McCain's declaration and self-flagellation comes at an interesting time in his senatorial career. He was recently censured by members of his own party in Arizona and is potentially facing a primary challenge in his 2016 re-election bid. I'm Liz Harrison, and this has been your Vigilant Liberty Radio news from Independent Journal Review for Monday, February 23rd.
Hi, this is Steve Hamilton, Station Director at AltCon Radio, and that sultry voice you're listening to is Liz Harrison on The Liz Harrison Show.
I'm back. It's been a day. I was getting ready for the show about 15 minutes before. Typical. Anyway. What was it? The terror threats. Yeah. We've had threats about terrorist attacks in malls all across the world, including Mall of America in Minnesota. I'm going to say right now, I don't think Minnesota has anything to worry about. It's too damn cold. Just saying. I know that seems rather flippant. Now, Rome is all upset. The Italian government is on high alert after threats from the Islamic State called Italy the nation signed with the blood of the cross, and the country would probably need help to confront the militant group. Italy is one of a handful of major Western countries that has not been victim of a large-scale terror assault since the September 11 attacks in the USA. The Vatican, the de facto seat of worldwide Christianity, is in Rome, so the city could be a target. Really? Okay. Now, that's out of USA Today. Do I want to see the Vatican attack? No, of course not. They're going to take every step they can to protect the Vatican, of course. My question is, are the Italians going to step in and, you know, start dropping bombs or putting boots on the ground? Just wondering. And what will Italians have to sacrifice for safety? Of course, here, Italo Finelli, 77, owner of a tobacco shop near the Pantheon in Rome, said he keeps an eye out for suspicious activity, but has not changed his day-to-day routine. Quote, I was a child during World War II and have seen good and bad times since then, he said. I have learned it is important not to overreact to either extreme. And Alessandro Tivoli, 29, a tour guide, said, you can't live your whole life in fear. And a quote from another person, you have to laugh, said Rafael Caruso, 78, a retired technician. It helps prevent you from being frightened. These people have the right attitude. We didn't. We went into full-on terrified mode. We gave up Pals of Freedom that has turned into NSA spying. Thank you, Mr. Snowden, for letting us know how deep it went, or at least some idea of how deep it went. No, I don't think we found the end of that rabbit hole, folks. We didn't find how deep it goes. We found part of it. And the sad part is that arguably you have more misuse than proper use of the invasions of privacy that we have going on now. We had people screaming bloody murder over a legislator in Texas who said that Muslims must take a pledge of allegiance to the United States. In other words, they must say that they are with us, not against us, in order to go to her office. What is wrong with that? She didn't say they had to do it to live here. She said they have to do it to enter a state building. And it's just a figurative type thing, arguably, because if they honestly wanted to do any harm down there, they were going to lie anyway. But at least it would have said, we're not taking it lying down. I don't see the problem. I really don't. Now, on to the really dirty job, because it does have to do with this. From the Washington Times. The federal government is looking for doctors to help monitor suspected smugglers' bowel movements at John F. Kennedy International Airport in New York. In a solicitation that sounds like it could be something out of the Discovery Channel's Dirty Jobs program. In reality, it's all a very sanitary process and even includes a special high-tech toilet to recover the drugs or other contraband from the other waste passing through the suspected smuggler system. But the details described in the new solicitation for doctors to assist U.S. Customs and Border Protection underscore the efforts smugglers will go to in trying to get their goods into the country and the lengths the government will go to try to flush them out. I guess that pun is intended. Oh my goodness. This is insane. doctors must be available round the clock in case CBP officers suspect they have a, quote, swallower, which is what internal drug smugglers are known as. The doctors are charged with X-raying or otherwise examining suspects' body cavities, and if drugs are found, the work order says, quote, the detainee may be held for a monitored bowel movement to wait the passage of the contraband material. During the MBM, the detainee will remain in the medical facility under the care and monitoring of the contractor. Oh, good God. Of course, we've seen this in movies. I can see the scene, but I can't think of the movie that it was in. The really horrible situation when somebody is being watched for this sort of thing, and the packaging that they put it in becomes degraded and they end up dying of an overdose. I'm laughing because if I don't, I'm going to, I don't know what I'll do. I'm laughing at the government, not the scene from the show. But, because, you know, it's not nice to sit there and say, oh, it's all right to go and do the drug overdose on the mules. That's just fine. Oh, good God. Yeah. Of course, they bring up the contract raises other concerns, including the potential for a female smuggler to be pregnant. The proposal says women who are suspected of having ingested contraband must be given a pregnancy test before they can be X-rayed. So, yeah, there you go, folks. That's how you get around it. You con a pregnant woman into doing this, which, of course, this is not new either. Oh, good God. Poop Patrol. Oh my goodness. And people wonder why I say legalize the drugs. Really? Come on now. Seriously. This is insane. It really is. It really, really is. I know there are people who get really upset with me because I say legalize them all. Because I'm sorry, what we're spending to try to stop it, the amount of international crime that we're begging to come to our own doorstep, isn't worth it. It really isn't. And honestly, if it was legal, that means it could be taxed. And I'm no fan of taxation under general circumstances, but, I mean, be real here, folks. Yeah, you'll still have a black market, but it will be severely decreased. You may have an uptick temporarily in drug use, but you'll have a tax revenue to cover the costs of treatment for individuals to get them off drugs. We don't have a specific revenue for this now, and the problem keeps growing. We have a shortage of drug treatment programs versus how many drug addicts we have. This isn't hard. If we're actually making money, and not the illegal way, not through civil asset forfeiture. Because that's the only way they make money off of this. They destroy all the drugs. Think about how much better it would be if they were legal. All the drugs. If they were all legal, you catch somebody who's doing it on the black market, do you destroy the drugs? No, you test them. You make sure that they're not too potent. If they are, then you rectify that issue. And then what do you do with it? Oh yeah, the government sells it. I know that sounds horrible, but it's revenue. It's revenue. You're not going to stop people from using drugs. Give up on it. It's not happening. So instead of trying to fight a battle you can't win, make money to give the people what they need. Do you really think that there are no capitalists out there that would be smart enough to sit there and say, okay, I want to be a drug dealer legally. And oh, by the way, I'm also going to go and foul to open up a drug treatment facility too. You think that won't happen? Oh, hell yes. Yes, it will. Get them coming in and going out. If it's all about the money, we won't see the problems that we've had now. We really won't. Initially, it will get rough, but in the long haul, we would be better off. And we wouldn't have to hire doctors to check poop. Really? Oh, good God. Anyway. Onward and upward. I may as well go to this one because, you know, Phyllis Schlafly would be flipping out over what I just said. She's 90 years old, still going strong. Okay. And she states in her update, Mrs. Schlafly, founder of the Eagle Forum, argues that her party too often picks losers as candidates because of the stranglehold by the political consultant, big business, Wall Street crowd, which she argues makes a bundle from supporting moderates over conservatives. Wow. Eric Erickson's real happy to hear her say this. She warns that may be happening again in 2016 in the persona of Jeb Bush. She notes, quote, closed-door events have been held for Republican megadonors to select who will get the big money that went last time to Mitt Romney, and that the mainstream media already are cheering on Mr. Bush. That should be a warning. If the mainstream media likes somebody, we should be running in fear. As evidence, she cites a New York Times article about how, quote, Jeb Bush is so smart, so intellectual, and so well-read, we were told that he is a top-drawer intellect and a voracious reader who maintains 25 books on his Kindle, books such as George Gilder's Knowledge and Power. Really? She goes on. Do you get the message that the media buildup for Jeb Bush has begun and that the 2016 Republican National Convention may simply nominate for president another establishment loser candidate? But it doesn't have to be. Some of us remember Everett Dirksen's famous speech at the 1952 Republican Convention when he publicly taunted the Kingmakers. We followed you before, and you led us down the path to defeat. Exactly. And we all know why they were talking about Jeb Bush being so well-read. Wink and nod, folks. They're afraid of Scott Walker. Hypocrisy. Hypocrisy. How many luminaries do we see on the left? I'm not talking about politics. I'm talking about professionals that do not have a college degree. Bill Gates comes to mind. Would anybody suggest that Bill Gates is too dumb to run for office? No. If anything, I'd argue that he's too smart. I've always said, and this always upsets politicians, it takes a special kind of stupid to put your name on the ballot. People have asked me, why have you never run for office? My standard reply has always been, I am too smart to run for office. It may sound arrogant. It probably is. But it's true. Because think about the hell that you go through. You like your privacy? Forget about it. You won't have it anymore. Doesn't happen. You will have no private life. Anything that you do wrong, any misstep, any wrong turn of phrase, and you make the headlines. What intelligent person wants a life like that? It takes a special kind of stupid to want to run for office. Learned and well-read. Whatever you say, he is part of a political dynasty, that's all. It could be argued that he got into the business of politics because it was the family business. Okay, we have a few minutes left, so I'm going to go to vdare.com. And this is somewhere where I've arguably never been before. It says, Je suis Brigitte. Brigitte Bardot, on trial again for insulting Muslims. And James Kirkpatrick, the author there, says, this is why contemptuous laughter is the only appropriate response when a Western politician talks about freedom. And then there is a quote from Breitbart. Former film star Brigitte Bardot, France's iconic blonde bombshell and sex kitten, who reigned supreme from 1952 to 1973, has been on trial 5 times for insulting Muslims and, quote, inciting racial hatred. The prosecutor in her fifth trial, Anne DeFontaine, wants a heftier fine and a tougher sentence, the equivalent of $24,000 and a 2-month, hopefully, suspended jail term. What crimes has Bardot committed in the land without a First Amendment, in the land of hate speech laws that are being slickly exploited by non-persecuted Muslims? Bardot has written, "I am fed up with being under the thumb of this population, which is destroying us, destroying our country." And Kirkpatrick goes on to explain, "Bardot's opposition is not rooted in the defense of Catholic France that animates the French right. She opposes Islamization largely because she feels it has a negative impact on animal rights. She always has been, an icon of the French left." So she wants to protect the animals. She doesn't like Islam. She doesn't like the fact that everyone is bending over backwards. Remember, je suis Charlie. Hypocrisy, thy name art France. And let's be honest, I mean, we didn't hear much about that here in the U.S. Arguably, the only reason why the journalists that have been killed got any positive press in France is because they were killed. France is largely apologist towards Islam, and that's probably an understatement. We heard talk about no man's land type territories around Paris that have been essentially taken over by Muslims, and it is dangerous to the point where even the police won't set foot there. Does that sound like freedom? No, it sounds like an incubator for extremism. This is multiculturalism at its worst. This is what happens when you abandon what it had been to become a citizen in the U.S. Yes, you may carry some part of what you were, your home country. Keep some degree of your ethnic identity. But the price to pay is that when you come here to America, you become an American. We've lost that. France arguably never did have it. No, you don't let your immigrants define your culture. You can let them enrich it, but they do not define it. There is a difference. I don't agree with Bardot. I mean, I could care less about animal rights. I don't agree with her motives, but I agree with her statements. She's pointing out the elephant in the room. Islam is slowly killing France. Anyway, it is about that time. So, 2 o'clock today, the right mics are on. After that, this evening, it is Monday. I have to think about it. Their finest hour is on at 10 p.m. So, have a great one. I am out of here. Yeah.
The staff of K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network is proud to announce that our very own Rowdy Rick Robinson has been selected as one of the top conservative talk show hosts in the nation for his program, America Off the Rails. Again, congratulations to Rowdy Rick Robinson for a job well done and another reason to stay connected to K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network. K98 Talk is expanding its lineup for 2015. This means we are expanding our advertising base. Whether you're a startup trying to push through to the next level or an established business trying to supplement your advertising budget, web-based advertising is a solid investment. Thanks to Talk's newest partnership with TuneIn Radio and instant access to our sister station, K98 FM, we give you worldwide access at a reasonable cost. Interested parties should email us at sales@k98fm.com.